Thank you, sir. Good evening, everybody. Today we are going to discuss handling and reporting of prostate specimen. I am Dr. Indranil Das from Kolkata. Today's lecture outline will be on surgical anatomy, specimen handling, the morphological features of prostate carcinoma, false negative diagnosis of cancer, mimicker of prostatic carcinoma, the Gleason score and the grade group, and lastly reporting temperature. So first we will discuss the surgical anatomy of prostate. The prostate is a walnut-sized gland located between the bladder and the penis. It is located just anterior to the rectum. The apex of the prostate is the inferiormost portion of the gland of the organ, and base is the superiormost portion. It has two lateral surfaces. On cross section, it has three zones, that is central, peripheral, and in between central and peripheral, there is transitional zone. Now, specimen handling. The following type of prostate specimen we receive in our histology lab, that is transrectal biopsy, transperineal biopsy, transurethral resection specimens, enucleation specimens, and radical prostatectomy specimens. First, we will discuss the steps in grossing of radical prostatectomy specimen. First, we need to measure the three-dimensional measurements of the prostate gland. Along with, we have to take the weight of the organ. Then we have to orient the specimen and ink the outer aspects. Different color can be used to ink the different surfaces of the prostate. Then distal apex is transected and it is sliced perpendicularly. In face sections, that is cross-sectional transverse sections at the apex for safe margin is not taken. Base is also transected and it is also sliced perpendicularly as of apex. Then the entire prostate, we take transverse section. During taking transverse section, if there is presence of any dominant tumor nodule, we need to take note of it. And if the nodule bulges beyond the prostatic contour, we have to note it down. The section from prostate to seminal vesicle is to be taken. And as per institutional protocol, entire prostatic tissue can be submitted. And in case of transurethral resection specimen, if the weight of the specimen is 12 gram or less, then entire specimen is submitted. And if the amount of tissue is more than 12 gram, then past 12 gram is taken in 8 blocks. And then for every 5 grams, one block is made. Now, what are the morphological criteria for diagnosis of prostate adenocarcinoma on needle biopsy? The foremost criteria is nucleomegaly, then prominent nucleoli with perinuclear halo and nucleolar margination. Multiple nucleoli may be present. Along with that, intraluminal crystalloids within the glands are seen. This is a very characteristic finding. It is not seen in the benign entities. In collagenous micronodules, these are nodular aggregate of oxycellular eosinophilic fibrillar stroma. This is quite specific for prostatic adenocarcinoma, as not found in benign lesions of prostate, and infraluminal blue tinge mucin. And if any prostatic gland is found in the perineural location, then it must be a malignant gland. The presence of intraluminal amorphous eosinophilic materials are sometimes described in the acinar adenocarcinoma. This is also a characteristic finding. And the glomeruloid structure or telescoping of glands. Sometimes the malignant glands retract from the surrounding stroma, creating a cleft. Sometimes the diagnostic criteria that I have mentioned, sometimes all the criteria are not found in a single biopsy specimen, or we fall short of the criteria for malignancy. Then a a diagnosis of atypical small SIN and proliferation can be made. It is basically a focus containing less than 24 SIN, and the length of the maximum length of the focus will be equal to or less than 1 millimeter. Certain criteria has been set for a diagnosis of atypical small SIN and proliferation, that is small size of the focus, disappearance of the atypical glands on the serial step sections, lack of cytological atypia such as nucleomegaly, and if there is presence of any background acute or chronic inflammation. Now we will discuss the intraductal carcinoma of prostate. Intraductal carcinoma of prostate basically carcinoma arising within the pre-existing prostatic ducts. The architecture of intraductal carcinoma are usually solid or dense cribriform. It may also be loose cribriform, micropapillary, or sometimes flat. The cells are cuboidal or columnar, and they typically exhibit marked nucleomegaly with prominent anisonucleosis. There are some major criteria for intraductal carcinoma, and there are some minor criteria. The major criteria are solid or dense cribriform arrangement of the glands. There should be marked nuclear atypia and nuclear pleomorphism along with the nucleomegaly. The size of the nuclei are more than the 6 times of the normal prostatic duct cell, and there should be presence of non-focal comedo necrosis. And what are the minor criteria? That is involvement of the many glands, irregular glands branching at right angles, and easily identifiable or frequent mitosis or high mitotic figures, and presence of two distinct cell population. The outer cells are tall, pleomorphic, and mitotically active, and inner cells are basically cuboidal, monomorphic, and they are less atypical, or they show less nuclear pleomorphism compared to the outer cell layer. The outer tall cells, the tall pleomorphic cells, are prostate-specific antigen negative, and the inner cuboidal cells show positive IHC staining with prostate-specific antigens. The intraductal carcinoma of prostate is usually associated with aggressive variant of prostatic adenocarcinoma, and it is an adverse prognostic marker. And presence of intraductal carcinoma on core biopsy basically correlates with seminal vesicle invasion at radical prostatectomy specimen. And the most important thing, another most important thing, if the entire prostatic tissue solely show the intraductal carcinoma, there is absence of any invasive component, then no Gleason grade is provided. Now, what are the differential diagnosis of intraductal carcinoma of prostate? The most important and foremost diagnosis is differential diagnosis is high-grade prostatic intraepithelial neoplasia. Both high-grade PIN and intraductal carcinoma of prostate are composed of cytologically atypical cells, but the intraductal carcinoma show much more architectural and cytological atypia. In both cases, the architecture of the cells may be flat, or micropapillary, or loose cribriform, but solidness and dense cribriform pattern are basically characteristic of intraductal carcinoma. It is not found in high-grade PIN. Moreover, the high-grade PIN glands are usually smooth with rounded contour. And the cells of intraductal carcinoma of prostate show more variation in the nuclear sizes. This is a picture of high-grade PIN. The nuclei are enlarged, but it is not more than the 2 to 3 times of the benign prostatic SINR cell nuclei. And anisonucleosis is little less than the intraductal carcinoma. In this chart, we have shown the gross microscopic difference between the high-grade PIN and intraductal carcinoma. As I said, high-grade PIN usually involve a few glands, whereas in intraductal carcinoma, a large number of glands are involved. The gland size are usually similar to the adjacent benign glands in case of high-grade PIN, But in case of endometrial carcinoma, the glands are often expanded, branching at right angles, and there are irregular gland with jagged outline. The nuclei are enlarged, but it is 2 to 3 times than the normal SNN nuclei. But in endometrial carcinoma, it is at least 6 times of the normal ductal cell nuclei. Comedonecrosis is not found in high-grade PIN, whereas non-focal comedonecrosis is quite characteristic of endometrial carcinoma. Now, what are the other differential diagnosis of endometrial carcinoma? That is atypical endometrial proliferation. It is basically a middle entity between the high-grade PIN and ductal carcinoma prostate. When the cellular architecture do not meet the threshold for definitive diagnosis of IBC endometrial carcinoma, but they exceed that of high-grade PIN, then this atypical endometrial proliferation diagnosis is made. The other differential diagnosis are invasive prostatic SNR adenocarcinoma with cribriform and solid growth pattern. The difference is made by the presence of lack of basal cells in case of invasive tumor, but in case of endometrial carcinoma, the basal cell layer is preserved. And another entity is prostatic ductal adenocarcinoma, where the cribriform architecture is prominent. This tumor also basal markers negative. This is atypical endometrial proliferation, this is loose cribriform architecture, whereas I said the solid architecture and the dense cribriform architecture are characteristic of or diagnostic of endometrial carcinoma prostate. But here the architecture is loose cribriform pattern. The ATPI is more than high grade PIN, but not amounting to as much of endometrial carcinoma. So the atypical endometrial proliferation diagnosis is made here. Now, prostatic ductal carcinoma. In prostatic ductal carcinoma, the tall columnar cells are present. They show cribriform pattern of growth with presence of slit-like spaces. Now, we will discuss the prostatic intraepithelial neoplasia. John McNeil first introduced the term, that is intraductal dysplasia. The term PIN was first coined by Bostwick and Breuer in 1987. PIN is characterized by cellular enhancement of the normal glandular architecture and presence of cytologically atypical cells. In low power view, the lining ductal structures are darker and thicker than the surrounding benign glands. These are benign normal glands, and this is PIN glands, and there is complex capillary pattern of growth. In high power view, we can see the nuclear enlargement along with vesicular or hyperchromatic nuclei and prominent nucleoli. The prominent nucleoli is much more common in case of high grade PIN. The low grade PIN shows variable nucleolar prominence. As I said, the low grade PIN is characterized by epithelial proliferation with nuclear stratification, nuclear crowding, and variable nuclear enlargement, that is anisonucleosis. Nucleoli may or may not be present. In high-grade PIN, the epithelial cells exhibit nuclear enlargement, hyperchromasia, and single or multiple nucleoli with perinuclear halo. But mitotic figures are not found in high-grade PIN. That is characteristic of endometrial carcinoma. Now, what are the histological variants of PIN? That is signet ring cell variant, mucinous variant, small cell variant, neuroendocrine variant, POMI variant, inverted variant, and PIN with squamous differentiation. Now, IHC study in PIN. The high molecular weight cytokeratin, that is basal marker, stain the basal cells. In case of high-grade PIN, the basal cell layer may be discontinuous, and it is highlighted by high molecular weight cytokeratin immunostain, and the PIN cells show positivity with alpha methyl CoA resmase, that is AMACR, AMACR. red chromogen has been used in ISC for amethyst, and brown chromogen has been used for ISC of high molecular weight cytoplasm. Now, what are the false negative histopathological diagnosis? I mean, in which setting we can falsely diagnose adenocarcinoma as a benign entity? The situations are that is tissue artifact, minimal or limited adenocarcinoma of prostate, deceptively benign appearing histological variants like atrophic variant, foamy gland variant, microcystic variant, or pseudo hyperplastic variant, single cell adenocarcinoma, and sometimes in treatment effect, in neoadjuvant treatment effect, that is androgen deprivation therapy or radiation therapy. We will discuss one by one. This is tissue artifact, the small focus of prostatic acinar adenocarcinoma. This is adenocarcinoma. In the background, there is inflammatory cells present, and these nuclei show crossing artifact. So nuclear detail cannot be clearly understood. So in that case, what we can do? We can introduce a amacar stain. If this is a carcinoma gland, then it will show a positive reaction. This red chromogen is used in case of amacar antibody, and it has given a positive reaction in malignant glands. Now, what is minimal or limited adenocarcinoma of prostate? It is a minute focus of adenocarcinoma that is less than 1 millimeter long and involving less than 5% of the tissue. Now, acinar adenocarcinoma variants. These variants may be falsely interpreted as benign entity. First, atrophic pattern adenocarcinoma. This pattern may develop sporadically or may develop after hormonal or radiation therapy. This variant is characterized by cytoplasmic volume loss as occur in case of benign atrophy. There is presence of single separate small glands showing infiltrative pattern of growth. These glands are angular or irregular, and growth pattern is infiltrative. It is not lobular or clustered. And atrophic pattern adenocarcinoma is considered Gleason pattern 3. So score of 3 plus 3, 6 is given. We will discuss Gleason scoring and grading later up of this lecture. Now, there is foamy gland adenocarcinoma. This is also a deceptively benign appearance. Microscopically, the foamy gland adenocarcinoma is characterized by abundant xanthomatous or foamy cytoplasm and pycnotic nuclei. It is blue pycnotic nuclei. The ISC with pancytokeratin, prostate-specific antigen, and NKX3.1 immunostain can detect this adenocarcinoma variant, and it should be differentiated. The carcinoma cells should be differentiated from the foamy macrophages, so they are negative for macrophage markers, that is CD68 or lysozyme. Now, microcystic pattern of acinar adenocarcinoma may be deceptively present as a benign entity. It displays intermediate size dilated glands. The glandular size may be 5 to 10 times of the surrounding benign glands or small acinar adenocarcinoma glands. But there is marked nuclear enlargement with prominent nucleoli and cytoplasmic volume loss. And as I said, the malignant glands are positive for amacar, and this tumor also are assigned a Gleason score of 3, Gleason score of 6. That means Gleason pattern 3 score will be 3 plus 3, 6, and grade group 1. Now, pseudo hyperplastic adenocarcinoma, it can be mistaken for a usual epithelial hyperplasia or complex normal gland. Microscopically, they reveal the architectural complexity, including papillary infolding, luminal undulation, branching, sometimes cystic dilatation. The Gleason score is 6, as the pattern is also considered pattern 3. Now, single cell adenocarcinoma, this scanning magnification of single cell adenocarcinoma, there is vaguely increase in the cellularity in the stroma, On higher magnification, you can see the cell nuclei are enlarged, hyperchromatic, and irregular. In case of diagnostic confusion, we can use immunohistochemical markers like pancytokeratin, NKX3.1, prostate-specific antigen. And if there is any confusion regarding these tumor cells as inflammatory cells, large atypical lymphocytes, then CD45 can also be used. This is a Gleason pattern 5 type growth, and Gleason score is 10 with gradebook of 5. Now, treatment effect. Sometimes androgen deprivation therapy changes the morphological detail of the adenocarcinoma cells. The androgen deprivation therapy given to tumors show cytoplasmic vacuolation with pycnotic nuclei, and the prominent nucleoli are absent. This is a case of radiation therapy treated prostatic carcinoma. These cells are viable, these glands are viable gland, and this area is showing the treatment effect by presence of vacuolated cells and pycnotic nuclei. Now, what are the mimickers of prostatic carcinoma? So, mimicker can be broadly divided into three categories, that is small gland pattern mimicker, the large and cribriform gland pattern mimicker, and solid or non-granular pattern mimicker. The small gland pattern mimickers are basically atrophy, adenosis, crowded benign glands, basal cell hyperplasia, vedumentinum, mucosal gland hyperplasia, a mesonephric remnant, Papar's gland, and the large and cribriform gland patterns are basically cribriform cell hyperplasia, clear cell cribriform hyperplasia, medium to large size hyperplastic glands. And the solid and non-granular patterns are sometimes confused with granulomatous prostatitis, prostatic xanthoma, paraganglia, signaling like cell, etc. Now, what is prostatic atrophy? Prostatic atrophy is basically an age-related process. Atrophy may be classified broadly into three categories, that is simple atrophy with cyst formation, and post-atrophic hyperplasia. In case of atrophy, the glands assume a lobular or circumscribed pattern of growth that is different from the adenocarcinoma adenocarcinoma with atrophic pattern. In that case, the growth pattern is infiltrated. Here, the glands maintain a lobular architecture. The partial atrophy usually appears as collection of crowded small pale glands, sometimes with a stellate shape, and cytoplasmic volume is less in case of prostatic atrophy. The nucleoli are absent and nuclear feature is bland. Now, this is post atrophy hyperplasia. Number of glands has been increased. The small regular acini are closely packed. In case of post atrophy hyperplasia, prominent nucleoli may be present, but in the background, the acute inflammatory cells are seen. The stroma in atrophy usually altered by a pale fibrosis. This pale fibrotic stroma should not be confused with a desmoplastic response to invasive prostatic carcinoma. And inflammation and corpora amyloidosa are more common in case of atrophy, and they are not usually found in case of adenocarcinoma. Now, atypical adenomatous hyperplasia or adenosis. Histologically, it is characterized by nodular proliferation of the closely packed gland. The glands often merge with the larger, more complex gland. On ISC, the basal cell are retained and amacar is negative. Now, sclerosing adenosis, it is characterized by circumscribed collection of small glands or tubular structure. It is separated by spindle cell stroma. Now, basal cell hyperplasia. Basically appear as variable size dark basophilic glands. Surrounding stroma is often cellular. Classically, they are found in the transition zone, but they may also occur in the peripheral zone. It is characterized by the two or more layer of basal cells, the range of growth pattern, including acinar, cribriform or pseudocribriform, and solid pattern. The differential diagnosis is high-grade PIN and adenocarcinoma. The distinguishing point is small basal nests, presence of microcalcification, and amacant negativity. Or radiation atypia, this can also be confused with acinar adenocarcinoma. And basal cell markers are positive. Now, verumontanum mucosal gland hyperplasia. Verumontanum is a place where prostatic utricle opens in the prostatic urethra. The verumontanum mucosal glands hyperplasia are characterized by closely packed small to medium sized glands, some of which contain eosinophilic secretions. This is basically an incidental finding in radical prostatectomy specimen, but sometimes they can also be found in needle biopsy material also. Now, seminal, vesicular, and ejaculatory duct, these are normal anatomical structures. This may also be confused with adenocarcinoma. This is a branching glandular structure, often with numerous glands. Nuclear hyperchromasia and smudge chromatin are more confusing, but presence of lipofuscin granule along with intranuclear inclusions are characteristic of seminal vesicle and ejaculatory duct epithelium. And the muscle wall is also a helpful tool. Now, copper or bulbo-ileostal gland, these glands may be sampled by needle biopsy or they may appear in TARP specimen. They are characterized by closely packed rounded mucinous gland with the central duct and lobular configuration. These are basically confused with foamy gland type of acinar adenocarcinoma and sometimes with clear cell cribriform hyperplasia of prostatic tissue. Now, mesonephric nerve remnants, these are small glandular structures, some with dense eosinophilic material. They characteristically lack the PSA and PAP expression, proxy-specific acid phosphatase expression, is helpful for diagnosis. Now, clear cell cribriform hyperplasia, this lesion is usually found in case of transitional zone as a part of benign nodular epithelial hyperplasia. They are characterized by complex cribriform proliferation of pale or clear cells. The cells are cuboidal to low columnar in shape. They lack cytological atypia, contains pycnotic nuclei, and the glands are surrounded by a basal layer of cell. Now, granulomatous prostates, these are confused with diffuse type of adenocarcinoma with recent pattern pipe growth. There are presence of seeds of dispersed inflammatory cells that may be confused with high-grade posterior adenocarcinoma. The presence of giant cells, macrophages, and adenocarcinoma with necrosis are diagnostic clue for granulomatous prostate. Now, prostatic xanthoma is another entity. It is characterized by collection of foamy macrophages that can potentially be confused with prostatic adenocarcinoma, composed of clear or foamy cells, that is Gleason grade 5 adenocarcinomas. ISC for cytokeratin, CD68 and amacar is helpful. These xanthoma cells will show a positive reaction with CD68. Now, leftover microscopic variants, that is mucinous or colloid carcinoma, they show a large amount of extracellular mucin containing the tumor cells. Then signaling cell carcinoma, the morphology is same as signaling cell carcinoma of other organs. Then sarcomatoid carcinoma, they show BGR spindle cells, nuclear hyperplasia, and pleomorphic giant cell rich adenocarcinoma of prostate. They show multinucleated pleomorphic tumor giant cells, along with meningeal cells in the background. Now, ductal adenocarcinoma, it is basically a subtype of prostatic adenocarcinoma characterized by presence of large glands lined by tall, pseudostratified atypical columnar cells. This tumor is commonly located in the periurethral area, that means central zone of the prostate, but they may often extend into the periphery of the organ. The glands of ductal adenocarcinoma are lined by tall columnar pseudostratified cells. Cytoplasm is amphiphilic or maybe eosinophilic. Nuclei are elongated and they show much more severe atypia than the acinar adenocarcinoma. the nuclear atypia is almost similar to that of endometrial carcinoma of prostate. Now the differentiating features of ductal adenocarcinoma from ascending adenocarcinoma is in ductal adenocarcinoma, the glandular architecture is more complex. There is papillary and cubiform pattern of both, and Ki-67 index is high in case of ductal adenocarcinoma. Except Ki-67, there is presence of no biomarker that can distinguish between the ductal adenocarcinoma and prostatic ascending adenocarcinoma. So it is mostly a morphologic diagnosis. Now we will discuss the Gleason score and the grade group. In 1966, Donald F. Gleason created Gleason's grading system based on the low power architectural features of the prostate cancer. In this architectural system, 5 grade system representing a continuum of progressively complex morphologies, that is primary or predominant pattern and secondary or second most prevalent pattern, are assigned a number of 1 to 5. The Gleason score 2 to 5 on needle biopsy specimen is not made, and if diagnosis of Gleason score 2 or 5 ascending adenocarcinoma is made, it should be made with very caution and excluding the benign entities like adenosis. The Gleason grade in the biopsy setting usually starts from Gleason grade 3. In grade 1, as described by Gleason, there is small uniform glands. In 2, there is more stroma in between the gland. In grade 3, pattern 3, there is distinctly infiltrative margins. In 4, there was irregular masses. And in 5, there is solid growth pattern, as described by Gleason. Numerous modification has been made after that. This is a Gleason score, Gleason's pattern 3. Variable size individual gland, typically smaller than those seen in the Gleason pattern 1 or 2 described by Gleason. The malignant glands infiltrate between the benign, these are the benign glands, the malignant glands infiltrate in between the benign glands. These are benign glands, and the malignant glands infiltrate in between the benign glands. The cribriform pattern of both defined as Gleason pattern 4. In the latest guideline, the glomeruloid pattern, vadocribriform gland pattern of growth are also graded as grade 4, and the fused gland, this is fused gland with no lumen, are also graded as grade 4. Now Gleason pattern 5 consists of sheets of tumor cells, individual cells, dispersed population of cells, cords, linear arrangement, and solid nests of cells. Coronary necrosis, that is defined by intraluminal necrotic cells and with or without karyorrhexis, is also graded as Gleason pattern 5. This is comedonecrosis containing karyorrhectic debris and abandoned necrosis. The solid growth pattern are also regarded as pattern 5 growth. Now, lower grade pattern should be ignored if the lower grade pattern occupy less than the 5% of the tumor volume. As for example, carcinoma showing pattern 4 in 98% of the area and pattern 3 in 2% of the tumor volume should be assigned a score of 4 plus 4. It should not be 4 plus 3, it should be 4 plus 4. And if a tumor otherwise have a Gleason score of 7, that is 4 plus 3 or 3 plus 4, but has a more than 5% pattern 5 nodule, the pattern 5 is assigned at the secondary pattern. That means the Gleason score will be 4 plus 5, not 4 plus 3. It will be 4 plus 5, a score of 9 will be given. And this specimen, in which the highest grade is Gleason score 7, it is recommended that the percentage of pattern 4 should be reported. Now, the Gleason grading system in setting of unusual morphological pattern, the foamy gland pattern are graded by the underlying architecture, the pseudohyperplastic pattern are graded as pattern 3 growth, atrophic pattern are also grade 3, the large duct carcinoma are 4, if the necrosis is present, or maybe in the comedonecrosis, it will be graded as grade 5, signet ring cell carcinoma are graded as grade 5, small cell carcinoma, adenosquamous carcinoma and sarcomatoid carcinoma are not graded according to the Gleason grading system. And if collagenous micronodule is present, they are also graded as grade 3. And mucinous carcinoma, predominantly 3 or 4, depending upon the underlying architecture. Now, grade group. The grade group was introduced to highlight the difference in prognosis between the grade 4 plus 3 and 3 plus 4, and also to avoid the incorrect assumption of Gleason score, as practically the score starts from 6. So grade group 1 is less than score less than equal to 6, grade group 2 is 3 plus 4, grade group 3 is Gleason score 4 plus 3, grade group 4 is score 8, that is 4 plus 4, 3 plus 5 or 5 plus 3, and grade group 5 is 9 or 10, that means 4 plus 5, 5 plus 4 or 5 plus 5. So a complete report should include, in case of radical prostatectomy, the clinical data, that means PSA, type of specimen, macroscopic examination, that is specimen weight, dimension, lymph node, and microscopic pathological data, that is histological type of the cancer, Gleason score, grade group, TNM staging, absence or extent of extraprostatic extension, bladder neck status, seminal vesicle invasion, margin status, presence or absence of vascular invasion. And if lymphadenectomy has been performed with radical prostatectomy, in radical prostatectomy, the number of nodes present in all site, right and left, and number of positive node and diameter of the largest tumor deposit should be mentioned. In case of TURP, the clinical data will be same, PSA and type of specimen. The macroscopic data is specimen wet, and microscopic data will be histological type, Gleason score, grade group, and TNM classification. In case of biopsies, the microscopic data should be, we get the biopsy specimen much often. There should be histological type of the cancer, number of core positive per slide, and usually we get 12 core biopsy. So number of cores positive per slide, per site, and to at least one of the following: total percentage of the cancer in all cores, the greatest percentage of cancer in one core, or at longest length of the tumor in one. Then presence or absence of preneural invasion, involvement of the adipose tissue by the tumor, Gleason sum score, and the grade. These are my differences.
Thank you, Dr. Indranil, for a wonderful lecture, and you have really nicely elaborated every aspect of conventional prostatic carcinoma as well as its variants, and also a lot of emphasis on the Gleason score and its grade system. I hope everybody will benefit from that. Thank you so much. God bless you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.